Welcome back, and thanks for joining us again. It's day two of MIREX. We hope you enjoyed day one, and we're pleased that you came back again for four brand new talks.
All right, let's do this. Who here has either a brother or a sister? Hands up, please. You know what I'm talking about. Growing up with siblings, there were times when you got along great. And there were times when you didn't. But you also knew that if you really wanted mom to do something, you absolutely had to get big sis or brother on your side. And sometimes they came through. And sometimes what you never thought would happen actually did. Well, professionally, we've all got those big brothers and sisters. And we need to work together to get some things done. Who are our big brothers and sisters? Well, outside of this room, who are the most influential people that you know? A government minister, a CEO, of course. But I bet on all of our lists of movers and shakers, there's someone on the UN, OSCE, the EU, one of those organizations. Now, why do they have the influence? Why do they have the power? Well, when we asked an independent researcher to ask more than 100 representatives of government, civil society, and donor organizations, whether or not, for example, the EU had the influence to actually make national government reforms happen, you know what they said? They said yes, 100% yes. So how is it that for many of us, we see the EU or the UN where we go and to ask for money, where we seek them as a donor? But what about when we're not asking for funding? What if we're not asking for them to fund a project? We're actually asking them to press on national governments for things that we know that desperately need to be done. And that's what I'm going to talk to you about today. How we have learned to work with the big international organizations and donors that have so much influence in the places where we are there to help, civil society organizations like World Vision, where our objective is clear. So we're going to talk today about an evidence-based practice called Partner Up. Here's some news, bad news. A civil society organization can't move a mountain on their own. Yes, together we can sort of tumble some rocks down the hill, but it's easy for governments to turn a deaf ear to us. Remember, we are working for some of the most vulnerable members of society. They don't have a voice, they don't have a lot of influence, and they don't have a lot of power. And so, what do? Remember, too, that the middle class and the wealthy, they don't have the same problems. They don't have the problems that the vulnerable do. If you've got money, you've probably got private health care. And if you have kids, you probably send them to private school. You might even have private security. So we can't count on them to use their influence to help the people that we serve. And as for politicians, don't get me wrong. They are out there, there's some good ones, but usually the only thing that gets them out is election day. And then they say some good things at election time. They say, education for all, health care, the children are our future. But once the election is safely away, those nice words can disappear. Out the window, a little puff of smoke. And yet, we have these big brothers, big sisters, who, when they talk, government actually listens. So how do we know? We've seen this happen. After the fall of communism, I think most of us can remember the images that came out of the Romanian orphanages. Heartbreaking stories of appalling conditions in institutions. The authorities were dragging their feet about bringing change, and they were given a really big incentive. At that point, securing membership in the European Union was Romania's number one priority. And all that needed to happen was that the EU was going to link future membership with child care and child protection. And all of a sudden, the mountain started to crumble. So Romania changed and its child care and provisions improved, and the EU's influence was that big. So seeing that happen, World Vision recognized the potential of working with organizations to carry out this sort of influence, and actually we could build a model with them to harness that potential. In the context of a four-year World Vision grant received from the Australian government, we worked to figure out how we can better partner up with these big, influential sister and brother organizations and governments at the top, that we could bring the much-needed child protection reforms in these five countries in Eastern Europe where we tested this. And guess what we saw? We saw again and again that it works. Leaders in these international organizations like the EU and the UN also want countries to be healthy and have stable societies. But their challenge is that they aren't grassroots, and they don't know what's happening at the local level like we do, and they certainly don't know what's happening in the poorest and most vulnerable communities. They want to, and they are keen. And when someone can give them that insight, it is gold. And when civil societies join up and partner up together to share those issues, they can actually provide a level of detail and insight to these IGOs that actually gives them the power to work. So together, we can all speak with one voice. And in those places of power and influence, we can advocate for the most critical issues that affect the poor and the marginalized. So let me give you a couple examples. The first one from 2011. World Vision Albania had surveyed the number of government-funded child protection units across the country. And according to legislation, there were supposed to be 394. The survey counted 28. So child protection units staff social workers in communities that handle cases of violence reported against children. And without this advocate voice and expert at local levels, children can't often get the help that they need. So in coalitions of civil society, World Vision invested heavily in child protection units themselves, offering training and support to social workers. And we built the credibility to speak about the needs of more CPUs. We shared this with government and with the EU. We attended EU invitation events, such as progress report and human rights country report sessions. And then we lobbied in Brussels, relying on our World Vision office in Brussels to build up the contacts and to set up meetings for us. The EU also attended events in Tirana. With members of the EU delegation, we were able to join up with them at key moments. So we started to see the numbers of CPUs funded and operated by government rise. And by the end of the project, the government had created a total of 189 CPUs. Here's another example. As part of our work in Armenia, civil society, that's World Vision and some local partners, we were pushing for a law on inclusive education to open up the mainstream schools to children with disabilities. And now, this was a critical step in Armenia because they had been putting children in with disabilities into institutions, and they'd become more and more marginalized. If children with disabilities could attend public schools in their own communities, then parents were often able to take care of their own children at home rather than sending them away to institutions. Well, because inclusive education is still or was still controversial in Armenia, the law was an important first step. Parliament submitted a bill for review in 2012, and so we partnered up. From 2012 to 2014, we worked hard on the EU, first to find the right person, and then to arrange meetings, and finally to lobby, cajole, persuade, over a period of time, to see that inclusive education, that we could make that difference together and that they could put the pressure back on national government. So we put inclusive education in the new national strategy on child protection in Armenia and asked the EU to continue that pressure over time. And that momentum built change. They used various diplomatic devices at their own disposal. The EU progress reports, they brought the issues up in meetings with ministers. And publicly, it was even put in the EU food program, where child protection benchmarks, including this very one, urged action by the national government. Well, in 2014, the parliament passed the Inclusive Education Bill, and the numbers of inclusive education schools began to rise. In 2010, there were 36. 5 years later, there were 100. Well, we tried this partnering up again and again, and over the course of 4 years, we've been able to verify that World Vision, in partnership with other local civil society organizations, contributed to 81 new measures, new policies, new implementation measures across five countries in Eastern Europe. And as a result, more than 2.3 million girls and boys received new rights and access to services that they hadn't before. And of that, 450,000 boys and girls were directly impacted by these new changes and changes in policy. These reforms, among other things, offer exclusive education for children with disabilities, add social workers to the local community level, create job standards for daycare and other services, and they also give effective and reliable care to children. Isn't that amazing? By working in partnership with other agencies and with these big brothers and big sisters, World Vision was able to impact for children on a scale much broader than we could in country by ourselves. In country, advocacy was good, but it could never achieve what we were able to achieve without our big brothers and sisters. That's not to say that we didn't work hard, but Partner Up has an overall roadmap to give guidance on two key steps I want to give today that show that we can interact with government donors in a different way to bring reforms at the national level. First and foremost, when they put out the welcome mat, we need to take up the invitation. The EU and the UN both hold periodic consultations with interested parties to find out their views. And these meetings do inform their policies. These consultations are open, and it can be the first step inside. And if we are prepared, these consultations can take on the form of written submissions and in-person meetings, and we should engage in both these levels of consultations. And it is not just the EU. Other bodies and donor governments also have consultation processes. The US State Department consults on the Human Rights Country Reports, and Council of Europe hosts a Child Rights Civil Society group, which World Vision is now a member of. There are a number of organizations who also have presence in Brussels and other global capitals, and as World Vision does. And we can use this presence to set one meeting, two meetings, and talk about the development of our work and on specific issues. And at the national level, we can work through foreign embassies to urge them to add their weight to the debate. And if you add the opportunities that come from partnership and coalitions that we are a part of, EuroChild, Child Pact, Concord, Interaction, and Special Sector Coalitions, then you can see that these two are a chance to lobby organizations and government donors so that they may lobby back to national governments. Second tactic, if you want to do this seriously, we need to look at the people who are tasked with advocacy and lobbying. There are people, personalities, and skills that are not afraid of this kind of work, this kind of outreach. Just like we have finance, HR, IT, we need to hire effectively for this experience, for this role, for people with experience in government and in international agencies who do not fear engagement and with any and all people of power or of influence. I bet that there isn't a single person watching this who hasn't spent time despairing of being able to get through a change they know to be vital and which they're sure will change lives. We know that these days, increasingly, we're going to have to use every tool at our disposal, and this one is critical. I can't guarantee that every door will be open or that we won't have to work hard to get our point across, but I can promise you that at the highest levels with these international organizations and donors, as we saw in Eastern Europe and in child protection reform, are people who are seeking this very input, insights that we can give them because we are working locally and seeing the needs in the communities. We are the link between the poorest and the most vulnerable people that we work with, and the people that have the power to change their lives. It's our job and our duty to make sure we are doing everything in our power to bring about the changes they so desperately need. And we simply need to partner up. We have seen through the practice of Partner Up that it works. 81 reforms, over 2.3 million boys and girls reached. The Partner Up evidence-based practice teaches that we can do this. Let's work more closely with our big brothers and sisters. We know it will bring results. If you want to know more about Partner Up or any of the Evidence for Change work that World Vision is doing, there is a website, wvevidenceforchange.org. Thank you.
Taking your cap off.
Has anyone got any money on them today? 5 euros, 10 euros, a different currency altogether. It really doesn't matter. Just looking for some money. Anyone? Oh, thank you. Now, we both agreed that this is your money, yes? And it's money that should be used to buy you the goods and services that are entitled to you by rights, right?
Yeah.
Okay, I have a proposition for you today. How would you feel if I decided how to spend this money in your interest?
Not okay.
Yeah, not okay, not so much. This is what I want to talk to you all about today. When it comes to providing services to people, what normally happens is that most of the decisions are taken by officials of the government or local authorities based upon their experience and their judgment and maybe some other factors. And if you know where to look and you look hard enough, you can probably find out about their budgets. But let's face it, it's not that easy. And if you knock on someone's door to say to them that you have a suggestion for how this money should be spent, well, honestly, I probably have to say good luck to you. My hope would at least be that they would be polite to you and give you a good reception. But I highly doubt you'd be invited in to work on the plans for their next fiscal year. And that's the point, because that's exactly what should be happening in the communities with which we work. But sadly, it doesn't often happen. I want to share with you an example with you. World Vision has been working in a community called Sisian, which is in the south of Armenia, about 200 kilometers from Yerevan. It's an area that's mountainous, it's heavily forested, and it's very, very beautiful. And for many, many years now, the people believe that the local government was planning according to their needs and that there wasn't much money for services. At least, that's what they'd been told by the government officials. So World Vision decided to pioneer an approach. The approach is called participatory budgeting. And that's the idea. If the services are for you, you ought to have some say, some participation as to what those services look like. In Sisian, the authorities agreed to be involved in this new practice, and it proved to be a real eye-opener for all who were concerned. Local people found out that the available budget was actually much bigger than they thought. They also found out that authorities thought all sorts of things were important that the people didn't think were quite essential at all. There is even money that had been sitting in an account for a while that almost everyone had forgotten about. This is the thing. Sisian is not an outlier. It's not some rare example in a system that typically works. I want you to think about the communities and the countries that you know and the places where you work. Does the story of Sisian sound familiar? Do you believe that if we scratch the surface of budget allocations, wherever we happen to be, wherever we're working, that we would find a similar situation as to Sisian's? Thankfully, Sisian's story ended up differently. With participatory budgeting, the budget was revised, and the community reallocated resources to the things that they thought were important, like renovating the kindergarten, or bringing in 4 extra staff, or setting up youth centers. What happened next was the attendance at the kindergarten went up, giving children a better start in the life has carried out in their schooling. Other budgeting was improved with pro-community allocation of resources. The community members, seeing the difference that could be made, are now active participants, leading to a much more vibrant and healthy community. And the allocation of resources is now seen as transparent, meaning that the relationship between the community and the authorities has improved. And the cherry on the cake, and I'm not kidding about this, they saved about $100,000. And once people get a taste for being involved, we found that they get quite good at it too. For example, in another community in Armenia, a local copper mining company was renting land belonging to the community and paying the local authorities more than $400,000 for the privilege of renting that land. Initially, just 10% of that money was earmarked for public services. But when the community negotiators got involved, they managed to get this figure increased to 27%. That's $75,000 to benefit the community. And I don't want to forget to give credit to the authorities in Sisian for even agreeing to be a part of this level of involvement with the community. But from their enlightened point of view, they saw the community as a whole had been the winner of the process. Well, by now it may not surprise you too much that wherever we looked, we found that when people do not participate in the budgeting process, leaders and government officials can continue planning without clearly knowing their real needs. And when people participate, it changes. As one counselor in Armenia told us, participatory budgeting helped us to understand that we don't understand the real priorities of the community. It was a revealing experience. We had a totally different and mistaken understanding of their needs. So the model that we all strive so hard to make sure that resources are allocated to meet the most pressing needs of the community, by and large, it just might not be working. And it's not just a problem of the government or the local authorities. Community leaders in one town, so not the government, had made plans for an office block to be renovated and a new car to be bought. With the introduction of genuine community participation and participatory budgeting, it turned out that the overwhelming majority of the community, they didn't want the office block, and they definitely didn't want the new cars. Instead, they wanted money spent on education and on healthcare. So even our community leaders sometimes need to make sure that they're really representing the community. Revision has now implemented the participatory budgeting practice in 28 communities in 4 different countries. And again, we found it to bring successful change. And the beautiful thing is that it's not actually a hard practice to implement. Let me tell you a little bit more of how it works. World Vision works with people from the community to train them and mentor them in spreading and gathering information into and from the community. The community is then trained to participate in decision making and trained to effectively represent the views of the community to government when it comes to the local budget allocations. They become a part of the process of planning, budgeting, and executing the budget. Now, you might be thinking, this sounds well and good, but isn't there a huge stumbling block? What about resistance you're likely to encounter from the government officials themselves by encroaching on their space, on their power? Well, participatory budgeting, or I'm gonna start calling it PB because it's just easier to say. It's just simpler. It just has to be introduced in a very simple way. We have to highlight the positives, and there are political positives. This is a process that helps people to see government as responsive and more transparent. It helps to counter some of the disaffection that we see so much these days. How could politics be corrupt and out of touch if it really does involve the people in some of the decisions that most directly affect them? And if more people feel encouraged to get involved in their communities and maybe even feel like they can see democracy working, then any clever politician is gonna like that. We're also very, very careful to make sure that the participatory budgeting process is a constructive one. It's about positive suggestions and propositions. These are the order of the day, not criticism. But, you know, I wanna be honest too. PB does mean that you need to work hard at first to inform local leaders as to what it is that they're being asked to come into and what's being attempted, what they're being asked to join. You can use the existing mechanisms, community consultations, community meetings, and so forth. And above all, you do need to be prepared to be persistent, patient, and thick-skinned. But our experience is that once government officials approach the value of PB, they adapt, they adopt it. And that, of course, leads to more influence and greater sustainability in the long run. And it's not just about the local government that appreciate the practice. Community members have reported that government officials who once did not listen to them now do, and that they now feel confident to understand the budget and make recommendations. Just think about this for a minute. There are almost no public services that are delivered without there being a budget attached. Now think for a moment, what would change if participatory budgeting was to be widely adopted wherever we work? Communities would have the chance to decide their priorities, and they, of course, are the best people to do that. But can you see how radical this would be? Communities would be involved in deciding every aspect of the services they receive. They could urge spending that responded to the urgent needs they saw around them. And that response could be faster than if the decisions were taken at government offices 40, 50, 100 kilometers away. In the 28 local government administrations In the four different countries where World Vision has been implementing this, there have been improvements in service delivery for families and communities. So, in Armenia and Bosnia, we saw changes in education, health, sanitation, child protection, that's the issue of addressing violence, livelihoods, children's welfare, gender, and women's rights. And in Albania and Georgia, there were changes in education and youth activism and child welfare. All as a result of the involvement of people with local communities who knew their needs and were now able to get them met. But to be really sure, because this is about evidence for change, we conducted a quasi-experimental study of PB, where World Vision compared the results from two communities where we used participatory budgeting with two communities where we didn't. And I want to share with you what we found. In the participatory budgeting communities, 85.2% said they had improved knowledge of planning and budgeting compared to only 27.8% in the non-intervention areas. 88.4% thought that they were better able to claim their rights related to the budget compared to only 27.3% in the other communities. 98.2% felt better able to influence planning and budgeting compared to 50% in the non-intervention areas. 72.2% thought local government more transparent and accountable compared to only 24.1% in the non-intervention areas. And this is what I'm most excited about. 77.8% reported noticing an improvement in service delivery compared to only 14.8% in the non-intervention areas. Of course, we're talking about a cultural change if participatory budgeting is to be widely adopted, but there is evidence now that says that that change is worth it. Yes, government would have to accept a different way of making financial decisions, but look at what we get in return. More active citizens, better represented with greater confidence that the system is working for them and is influenced by them. In fact, we're talking about greater accountability, greater transparency, and in short, a better form of democracy. And if you're not swayed by improvements to individual lives, then how does a better society sound to you? Finally, if anyone's worried about what happened to this to Jocelyn's note that she so kindly entrusted to me at the start of this talk, let's make sure it gets back to her. As I hope we can all see and now and agree, that she's actually the one who could decide better about how it's spent. Thank you for your attention today. If you want to know more about participatory budgeting practices or any of the evidence for change work that World Vision is doing, there's a website, wvevidenceforchange.org. Thank you.
We hope you're enjoying these talks and discovering the ways in which you and your office can make use of this evidence in your work. Remember, you can watch these talks again and share them with your colleagues and donors by visiting the website wvevidenceforchange.org. Thanks for joining us.
How many of you are the youngest child? I sympathize with you. I am the youngest of four children. My big brother Samer is the oldest. When I was little, he told me that when I grow up, I would be a princess. And I believed him. I used to select dresses that made me look like a princess. I used to act like a princess and even try to walk like a princess. I fully believed him until I was 7 years old and realized that my father, while a wonderful man, is in fact not a king. Where I work in Palestine, women who have babies at a young age are told by their mothers and mothers-in-law that their breast milk is not enough. They are told it will not help their babies to grow properly, and instead, the baby should have formula. They are also told many other things, such as to put salt on the umbilical cord. It will help them to heal faster, and to add salt on the baby's skin to help the babies fight infection. They believe that adding kohol to the eyes of the babies will make their eyes beautiful and will improve their eyesight. and some babies are even fed food from family meals at the age of 40 days because it's a treat for them. That's what they believed. Every year, more than 6.5 million children die before they reach their fifth birthday. Around half of these deaths happen in the first 28 days of baby's life. Of course, the worst affected people live in the poorest area. And I know because I have seen this in my work. I'm a technical lead for health and nutrition in World Vision's office in Jerusalem, West Bank and Gaza. Every day I work with our programming in Palestine and I see the impact of the contest on the health of women and children. The health system is very fragmented. Restrictions on free movement of people as a result of the occupation have seriously impacted the provision of efficient and effective healthcare in the West Bank. So much so, the World Health Organization estimated in 2012 that access to essential health services is impeded for nearly 1 million people in the West Bank and around 1.4 million people in Gaza. Yet roughly 40% of the population is either women of reproductive age or children under 5. Children die at the rate of 20 per thousand live birth in the West Bank and 25 per thousand in Gaza. The anemia prevalence rate is double that of Europe, and exclusive breastfeeding is estimated at only 26.5%. A study in the Bethlehem district found that many of the reasons for this low rate were social and linked to family pressure and perceptions of poor quality of breast milk, like the story I shared with you. Yet breastfeeding is incredibly important. A study published in the medical journal, The Lancet, shows that exclusive breastfeeding for the first 6 months of child life reduces under 5 death by 13%. And complementary feeding and continued breastfeeding past 6 months reduces under 5 child mortality by 6%. There are many other gaps. Parents are subjecting their infants to harmful practices, believing that those practices are good for them. We decided that we needed to do something about this profoundly depressing fact. So we piloted a health approach called Timed and Targeted Counseling, or TTC. TTC is an innovative and adaptive practice that is effective at improving maternal, newborn, and child health and nutrition outcomes, exactly the need we were facing in Bethlehem. The practice specifically builds the capacities of families, communities, and governments to make the necessary health interventions to reduce the morbidity and mortality rates of newborns and mothers. TTC is delivered at the household level by a trained group of community health workers. Usually, they are volunteers. The model provides advice for the crucial early days of child's life from the third trimester of pregnancy through its first birthday of baby's age. Through the model, community health workers become regular visitors to the homes where a mother is expecting or caring for a young child. These workers give accurate, preventive, care-seeking advice to the primary caregivers, as well to other members of the household. These are people who make decisions or giving advice on raising the child, such as mothers-in-law and grandmothers. With each visit, the volunteer monitors the outcomes of the previous counseling while providing new advice appropriate to the child's development stage. This work is also supported on community and national levels. At the community level, the capacity of community groups is built to address and monitor local cases of illness, death, and malnutrition. They work for quality health service delivery, monitor home-based care services, and help to build a good environment for positive health outcomes. On the national level, partnerships are formed with national government and other key stakeholders to ensure community-level quality of health and nutrition services. All these efforts are focused towards strengthening existing community-level structures to improve child well-being in sustainable ways. The original pilot of TTC aimed to reach 330 households in 11 communities in Bethlehem. And through the work, we quickly saw that TTC is highly effective and efficient model, very relevant to the context and the needs of the target population in Bethlehem. It also showed a high return on investment and with potential for sustainability. How do we know it's highly effective and efficient? We tested it, comparing the results in Bethlehem communities where World Vision used TTC with communities where we did not. Remember the Lancet study that shows exclusive breastfeeding for the first 6 months of child's life reduces under 5 deaths by 13%. Because of TTC, 42% more mothers in Bethlehem are exclusively breastfeeding than in the non-TTC group where World Vision did not have any interventions. 27% more are breastfeeding above 1 year, and 33.2% more mothers are able to recognize danger signs in their baby's health. 28.8% more mothers are managing diarrhea appropriately. We also saw increases in the TTC households of pregnant women taking iron and folic acid, in mothers knowing the danger signs of pregnancy and postpartum danger signs. Nutrition improved. There was a 50.4% increase in children with minimum dietary diversity and 71.7% increase in minimum meal frequency. These are all interventions that reduce under 5 mortality. The secret to the model is that it delivers the right information at the right time to mothers and caregivers. Information that is timed and targeted. It delivers advice to mothers for their exact stage of pregnancy or the life of their child. In the intimacy of the home, the community health workers are able to influence behavioral change, enabling the mothers to make good and right choices. Mothers become more confident. They have a source of information that they can rely on. The TTC model is also highly cost effective, with minimal setup and infrastructure cost to consider. It draws on existing structures and early partner and government involvement. It focuses on social and family connections that increase the efficiency of knowledge sharing across a community. In Bethlehem, the model cost around $120 per household. The evaluation in Bethlehem undertook a cost effectiveness analysis and found that in this context, TTC came 7 times under the World Health Organization benchmark for cost effectiveness. I'm here today to share with you the success that I saw this model have. It works as intended to empower women and caregivers to make positive health decisions for themselves and their infants, alongside greater support from husbands and family members. And it's not just me who believes this. The majority of community health workers interviewed in Bethlehem TTC evaluation mentioned that a woman in targeted households have started to discuss childcare issues with their husbands, while the caregivers interviewed believed that there was now more cooperation between men and women in raising their children. The evaluation also found that all the right elements are in place in Bethlehem for continuation of TTC and its sustainability. This includes local ownership, community-based capacities, and strengthening partnership between communities and key governmental stakeholders. The model has established collaborative networks between organizations, community health workers, community health groups, primary healthcare staff, and the Ministry of Health, all of whom are now willing to support and invest in the resources required for the model to function. The evaluation also showed the importance of close collaboration and coordination efforts with the Ministry of Health while planning and implementing the TTC model, including direct involvement in training and supervision of the community health workers. Based on the evidence of contribution to change collected in this context and the commonalities of the situation in Bethlehem with many others in the world, TTC is recommended as a model for achieving sustained health and nutritional improvements for the well-being of mother and children across many other contexts. With World Vision, the TCC evidence-based practice is already being scaled with confidence from the area program in Bethlehem to all 14 World Vision local program areas as a core technical approach for improved maternal, newborn, and child health and nutrition across West Bank. Results from these projects also show comparable and significant improvements in health and nutrition practices at household levels. We believe that if TTC were to be more widely adopted in those areas where we continue to see horribly high levels of maternal mortality and infant death, we could start to see a shift to a world where, whatever your level of income, pregnancy could be seen as a happy and healthy time, and infancy would just be about the joy of having a new soul growing in the world. There was no lasting damage for me, believing that someday I would be a princess. After all, in the eyes of my father, I am a princess, but other cultural beliefs can be really dangerous. Let's get the right counseling at the right time, in the hands of those that need it most. There is no greater happiness than saving the lives of people in need and supporting them to be healthy, regardless of all the challenges. After all, aren't all babies prince and princess? If you want to know more about timed and targeted counseling or any of the evidence for change work that World Vision is doing, there is a website, wvevidenceforchange.org. Thank you.
I hope you are enjoying Murex. Thank you so much for coming. As you can probably tell by now, we are big believers in evidence-based practices. They enable us to learn from what has worked before, and they give us a stronger start to new programs. But we also equally are big believers in World Vision's transformational development approach. Our community-based presence and engagement are critical to our work, enabling us to establish relationships and understand the needs of local communities with whom we partner. Sometimes, however, we hear some skepticism about bringing these two together, that field staff do not believe project models can work for them, or that technical staff hesitate about local adaptations. We find debates in our organization between the technical and the geographic, between project models and community presence. But we're here to say that we believe it's both. Our experience says it's both, that it's always both. The more these two can learn to work together in harmony, the greater our outcomes for our programming will be. I was with World Vision Albania and Kosovo for their day of prayer this past year. In the months prior, the office had been going through a process where they were socializing their strategy. In other words, they wanted to make sure that everyone in the office understood the change they were trying to achieve and the ways in which they were trying to achieve it. They wanted all staff, whether development facilitators or technical staff, finance or PNC, to work in greater harmony towards this end. That night, the evening turned to traditional dance. As I watched all staff dance in such beautiful harmony and coordination together, I thought, this is how it is supposed to be in our day-to-day work. And I said to them that ultimately, it is about learning to dance together. Sometimes an evidence-based practice has transformational development built into it. That happens when a practice has a focus on the most vulnerable, or on transforming relationships, systems, and structures, as well as engaging with faith partners. Other times, transformational development provides the context where the practice can be nested. Evidence-based practices need to be nurtured. They need to be implemented in a context that helps them flourish. World Vision's approach to transformational development enables this flourishing. When we are listening to communities, understanding their needs, and therefore better able to identify the project model that responds to those needs. When we are in prayer and discerning, when we're focused on the most vulnerable or seeking to help them restore harmony in their relationships, when we ourselves demonstrate grace and love. These are all ways in which we create a context for transformational development. These are all ways that will enhance and add value to our evidence-based practices. This is our hope. This is what we believe as a region, that as an organization, together, we will constantly be creating, adapting, nurturing, and even dancing with one another to bring evidence-based practice to work in harmony with our transformational development approach. Thank you.
Thank you very much. I have a quick quiz for you. Question one, you have two children in a classroom. One of them is quiet, but academically bright. The other one is noisy, but he's not doing very well with his lessons. Which of them do you think is going to drop out of school? Question two, a child is living in a rural area, the other one in urban setting. Which one of them is more likely to drop out of school? Question three, are the poorest and most vulnerable children more likely to benefit from a program that aims to prevent their dropping out of school? So think about these three questions, and I believe they are worth thinking. So what keeps a child in school and what influences them to continue education is actually a very complicated thing. And that is why, as part of Choose School project, World Vision Romania partnered with Babeș-Bolyai University to actually do a research that studies the factor that lead children to stay in school and prevents them from dropping out. Okay, first, let's establish why we want children to be in school. Of course, we want the most vulnerable children and the poorest one to be able to escape this trap of poverty that is intergenerational. Because education is linked to the most important development goals that we want for ourselves. It improves the child's confidence, it improves the economic prospects, it improves the health, and it prevents the spread of disease. It is not only good for the child, it's good for the community, and it's good for the society at large. So, it is not only a need for the society, but is a fundamental right of the children, of all the children. Because otherwise, the child's life is harder, not only as a child, but it makes it harder later in life for his future. Okay, so we agree that education is good for every child, but for the children who are the poorest or part of the vulnerable groups, this is harder to achieve. You have to make sure that the child has a chance to go to a good school. But more than that, you have to do everything necessary to keep them in school. And first things we found in our research is that keeping a child in school is actually a very complicated thing. There are a large number of factors that are actually influencing a child dropping out of school. First are reasons that have to do with their family or with their community and with the society at large, that all can have an influence on the child. So where do you start? In Romania, where we pioneered this project, we realized that we need a partner, and not just any partner. We needed somebody who had the influence and the ability to reach into as many of the poorest communities as possible. And luckily, we had the right partner in the Romanian Orthodox Church. They have a presence basically in every community, they have huge influence, and we share the same values. So our partnership was already in place since 2006 when we started together the first youth Bible curricula that helped the church organize its first Sunday schools in Romania. So let me tell you a little bit about the context of Romania. Since 2010, in Romania, the school dropout is on the rise. Everybody agrees that education is a critical element for the entire country's development. A lot of work had to be done to look at what is the situation. And the picture that we revealed had to do with poor educated parents that weren't able to understand what is the value added of the education for their children. We found poorly educated workforce who was actually going west to find jobs. And we found people who were being trafficked for their labor from communities where criminality was increasing and there was little understanding of the importance of the democratic processes. So pretty much some fairly fundamental problems. Our goal in our partnership, in this partnership with the Romanian Orthodox Church, was to develop a mechanism that would prevent children from dropping out of school and staying in education. We started in 2009, and our program, funded by the European Social Fund, was a 6 million program that ended up reaching 32,000 children and over 2,000 parents in over 3,000 parishes. That's impressive. And not only that, but critically, we were able to involve over 3,000 priests and teachers who have become part of this program. The children who took part in the program were selected with the support of the priests in their communities based on their level of vulnerability. So these were the children who were the most at risk of dropping out of school. We carried out an initial assessment when they entered the program to identify some of their attitudes towards school, some of their attitude towards themselves, in order to be able to profile each of the participants in the project. After they've been through this program, we assessed them again. And we wanted to see what kinds of changes have taken place for these children and how can we make it more effective for the children. It allowed us to refine the program. And as part of this assessment, we were able to build a picture of the children taking part, including their ethnicity, their parents' income, whether or not they had one or both parents working abroad. Majority of the children were coming from urban settings. We had a little over 50% of the children coming from urban settings and under 50% from rural settings. We also had 10% of the children Roma. And we made sure to include children who came from families whose income was under 250 euros per month. It's interesting to note that more than a third of these children had one or both parents working abroad. But on the practical aspects of the program, we developed a set of tools for the priests and for the teachers. And with these tools, we helped the priests setting up Sunday schools. During the Sunday schools, the priests were trained how to look for those talented children, for those children who had a special ability, and how they can build that special ability for the child. It became obvious that we needed to work on building the child's motivation to be integrated with their schools, with their peers. We did this using a value-based approach, discussing children's Christian values in the Sunday schools and in the youth groups, and developing their skills and abilities. For example, we ran summer camps. In the summer camps, the children were able to work with special instructors who helped them further develop their God-given abilities. Here's an example of what was achieved as a result of this program. At 16, Romeo already had a criminal record. He had abandoned school at 12 when he joined a criminal chain that was using children for theft somewhere outside of the country in the West. Romeo was becoming a father that summer. And although he was not an Orthodox child, he was identified by the priest in his community as being vulnerable. and at risk of actually ending up in prison. At the end of the summer camp, Romeo said, "I have learned here that my life doesn't have to be like this. In fear, stealing, and risking my life and my freedom every day. I learned handcrafts, and I know now that I can do something beautiful with my hands and can be a breadwinner for my child. Before the summer camp, nobody gave me anything for free. Before the summer camp, nobody made me feel valuable." So as you can see, that this kind of work over time is breaking the vicious cycle and allows a virtuous cycle where children and young people are given a sense of worth, a self-worth, where they can develop their abilities and helps them feel like they belong into their group of peers. They belong to their community. This reinforces their commitment to attend. It helps them achieve. It helps them feel like part of their school group again. So going back to the quiz, CHU School demonstrated that the child with stronger connections is more likely to finish school than the child who is academically brighter. It showed that the most vulnerable children actually benefit the most from a program that aims to keep them in school. And it also shows that although children in rural areas are more likely to drop out of school, if you have a partner who has continuous presence and influence, like the church in our case, that can break the cycle of exclusion. It can provide children with a new sense of self-worth and a new sense of avoiding risks of dropping out of school. But nothing that's worth having, it's easy. So we had to work really hard at the beginning of this program to win the trust, first of all, to win the trust of the church, to win the trust of the individual clergy and the teachers who worked with us, and eventually to win the trust of the children and to keep our promise to them. This is an approach that is focusing on the individual child, and it's time consuming. You need to have trained people to spend time with the children, to bring out the best of them. You need to build their confidence. And once you're doing that, their integration into school is actually very robust. So what did we learn? We learned that you can be more successful at keeping children in school by working with them and their families and not just with the schools. We learned that in Romania, the church was an ideal partner. It is highly respected and influential. It has a presence even in the smallest community. It has been a unique partner in terms of outreach to the most vulnerable children. The model will have to be tested and adapted to see how it works with a different partner. But most of all, what we learned was that the project, CHU School project, had a statistically significant positive effect on the participants' attitude towards their education. Items analyzed show that the intervention produces changes with positive, desirable effects in all of the variables investigated. Statistically significant. That means that we know with absolute confidence, because the research shows that this was not a random change. Influencing children's attitude towards school, such as their perception of its usefulness, their motivation for it, or the relevance for their future, increases their self-confidence and their association of it with a sense of security. This is what brings the change. This approach does prevent them from dropping out. Moreover, the magnitude of the change was consistently high. From a research standpoint, for all the children, with very few exceptions. And what is the most amazing is that while it was high for all the children, the results were even greater for the children with the biggest problems, the most vulnerable, the children from the Roma community, the children who are the most likely to drop out of school. And this is good news for World Vision, because we are focusing on the most vulnerable children. I believe very strongly that we have here a model that can radically affect the children's attitude towards school and keep them learning where before they would have dropped out of school. We have seen changing in attitudes in all the areas that we wanted, and we have seen children delighted and happy in an environment that previously was frightening and cold. And that's why I commend Choose School as a model for change. If you want to know more about Choose School or any of the other evidence for change work that World Vision is doing, here's a website for you, wvevidenceforchange.org. Thank you.
Thank you for joining MIREX. We hope you enjoyed it, and we hope you come back tomorrow.